You're listening to the audio production of Then Sings My Soul, Special Edition by Robert J. Morgan, published by Thomas Nelson and read by the author. Please note that you may download an accompanying PDF that provides enhanced materials for this audiobook. To download the PDF, please visit harperchristianaudio.com.
From Heaven Above to Earth I Come, published in 1531. Then God blessed them, and God said to them, Be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it. Genesis 1:28. Martin Luther never expected to marry, for he had taken a vow of celibacy as an Augustinian monk. Even after discovering the great Reformation truths of Scripture alone, faith alone, he still intended to keep his vow. As the Reformation picked up steam and other monks began to marry, he exclaimed, Good heavens, they won't give me a wife. It wasn't just monks who were renouncing their celibacy, however. It was nuns, too. When Luther heard that a group of nuns from a nearby cloister wanted to escape their situation, which amounted to virtual captivity, he agreed to help them, though doing so was a serious violation of the law. Enlisting the aid of a local merchant named Leonard Knopp, 60, Luther arranged for the nuns to be smuggled out in empty barrels used to deliver herring to the nunnery. It was a fishy plan if ever there was one, but it worked. Having liberated these women, Luther now felt responsible for placing them in homes. He managed to find husbands for all but one of them, Katharina von Bora. 2 years passed, and Luther was deeply troubled by his failure to find her a husband. She was now 26 years old, brilliant and effervescent, but still unclaimed. In a visit to his parents, Luther, who was 42, joked that he might have to marry Katharina himself. His dad heartily endorsed the idea, and to make a long story short, the two were married on June 27, 1525. By autumn, Katharina informed Martin that she was pregnant, and Luther cheerfully announced, My Katharina is fulfilling Genesis 1:28, the verse about being fruitful and multiplying. There's about to be a child born of a monk and a nun, he bragged to his friends. Accordingly, little Hans was born on June 7, 1526. Luther was devoted to his son, and 5 years later he wrote this Christmas carol for him. Luther called it A Christmas Child's Song Concerning the Lord Jesus, and it was sung each year during the Christmas Eve festivities at Luther's massive home, a former Augustinian monastery, on the upper end of Wittenberg's main street. For over 500 years, it has been one of Lutheranism's greatest carols, delighting children today just as it thrilled little Hans in the 16th century. We sing Emmanuel thy praise, 1654. I will be glad and rejoice in you. I will sing praise to your name, O Most High. Psalm 9:2. Paul Gerhardt might be called the Charles Wesley of Germany, for he was a prolific hymnist who gave Lutheranism some of its warmest hymns. Paul grew up in a town not too far from Berlin, where his father was the mayor. This village near Wittenberg was devastated by the Thirty Years' War, and Paul's childhood was marked by scenes of bloodshed and death. But he had a good mind and heart, and he enrolled at the University of Wittenberg at the age of 21. After graduation, Paul found a job in Berlin tutoring children. But during this time, encouraged by Johann Kruger, choirmaster at Berlin St. Nicholas Church, he began writing hymns. When Kruger published a hymn book in 1648, Paul was delighted to find his own hymns in it. Others were added to later editions. In all, Gerhardt wrote 123 hymns. His hymnody reflects the shift from the rugged theological hymns of Luther to the more subjective devotional hymns of German pietistic revival writers. Best known are Give to the winds your fears, Jesus, thy boundless love to me, and O sacred head now wounded, which he translated. Paul was ordained into the ministry at the age of 44 and began preaching in and around Berlin. In 1651, he became the chief pastor at Mittenwald, just outside of Berlin, and later he returned to Berlin to labor at St. Nicholas Church alongside his mentor, Johann Kruger. At that point, however, Paul became embroiled in a conflict with the elector Friedrich Wilhelm, who wanted Lutheran clergymen to sign an edict limiting their freedom of speech on theological matters. Refusing, Paul was deposed from his pulpit in February of 1666. He was even forbidden to lead private worship in his home. During this time, four of his five children died, and in 1668, his wife also passed away. Later that year, 1668, Paul assumed the pastorate of the Lutheran Church in Leuben-on-Despree, where he ministered faithfully until his death on May 27th of 1676. He was buried in the crypt beneath the altar of the church where he preached, and today the church is known locally as the Paul Gerhardt Church. A monument at the entrance reminds visitors of the church's famous pastor and poet. This Christmas carol, we sing Emmanuel, Thy Praise, has a hauntingly beautiful melody that seems to express the sorrows through which Gerhardt passed. But the words are full of praise, every verse ending in the exuberant word Hallelujah, just like Paul Gerhardt's life. While shepherds watch their flocks, 1700. He will feed his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs with his arm and carry them in his bosom and gently lead those who are with young. Isaiah 40, verse 11. This popular carol owes its endurance to two men with dark financial woes. The first, Nahum Tate, was born in Dublin in 1652 to a preacher who was literally named Faithful, Reverend Faithful Tate. After attending Trinity College in Dublin, young Nahum migrated to London to be a writer. His success was slow in coming, but he dabbled with plays, adapted the prose of others, and eventually was named Poet Laureate in 1692 and appointed Royal Historiographer 10 years later. Unfortunately, Nahum was intemperate and careless in handling money, and he lived in perpetual financial distress. He died in an institution for debtors in 1715. His chief claim to fame was his collaboration with Nicholas Brady in compiling a hymn book entitled The New Version of the Psalms of David, published in 1696. It was reissued in 1700 with a supplement in which this Christmas carol first appeared. The words to While Shepherds Watch Their Flocks represent a paraphrase of Luke chapter 2, verses 18 through 14, making this one of our most biblically accurate Christmas carols. The second man instrumental in the song's success was George Friedrich Handel, composer of the music to which the carol is sung. Handel was born in Germany with an inborn talent of musical genius. His father pressured the young man to enter law school, but George would not be denied, writing his first composition by age 12 and amazing choir masters with his artistry. He eventually moved to London, where he enjoyed great success for a season. Then his popularity waned, his income dwindled, and he went bankrupt. It was the remarkable success of Messiah that salvaged Handel's career and his bank account. Through it all, Handel's powerful personality pressed on. How ironic. These two men never met. They both struggled with poverty, faced bankruptcy, and worried about making ends meet. And yet, they enriched the world beyond measure, providing millions of people for scores of generations with the gift of song sung every Advent season. Joy to the World, 17:19. Shout joyfully to the Lord, all the earth. Break forth in song. Rejoice and sing praises. Psalm 98:4. Until Isaac Watts came along, most of the singing in British churches was from the Psalms of David. The church, especially the Church of Scotland, had labored over the Psalms with great effort and scholarship, translating them into poems with rhyme and rhythm suitable for singing. As a young man in Southampton, Isaac had become dissatisfied with the quality of singing, and he keenly felt the limitations of being able to sing only these psalms, and so he invented, as it were, the English hymn. He did not, however, neglect the psalms. In 1719, he published a unique hymnal, one in which he had translated, interpreted, and paraphrased the Old Testament psalms through the eyes of New Testament faith. He called it simply, "The Psalms of David Imitated in the Language of the New Testament." Taking various psalms, he studied them from the perspective of Jesus and the New Testament, and then formed them into verses for singing. He explained, "I have rather expressed myself as I may suppose that David would have done if he had lived in the days of Christianity, and by this means perhaps I have sometimes hit upon the true intent of the Spirit of God in those verses further and clearer than David himself could ever discover." Watts' archenemy, Thomas Bradbury, was greatly critical of Watts' songs, which he called whims instead of hymns. He accused Watts of thinking that he was King David. Watts replied in a letter, "You tell me that I rival it with David, whether he or I be the sweetest psalmist in Israel. I abhor the thought. Yet while at the same time, I am fully persuaded that the Jewish psalm book was never designed to be the only psalter for the Christian faith." Joy to the World is Isaac Watts' interpretation of Psalm 98, which says, "Shout joyfully to the Lord, all the earth." As he read Psalm 98, Isaac pondered the real reason for shouting joyfully to the Lord. The Messiah has come to redeem us. The result, despite the now-forgotten criticisms of men like Bradbury, has been a timeless carol that has brightened our Christmases for nearly 300 years. Hark, the herald angels sing. 1739. Then the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I am bringing you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people." Luke chapter 2, verse 10. Upon his conversion, Charles Wesley immediately began writing hymns, each one of them packed with doctrine, and all of them exhibiting strength and sensitivity, both beauty and theological brawn. He wrote constantly, and even on horseback his mind was flooded with new songs. He often stopped at houses along the road and ran in asking for pen and ink. He would say, "Pen and ink." He wrote more than 6,000 hymns during his life, and he didn't like people tinkering with the words. In one of his hymnals he wrote, "I beg leave to mention a thought which has long been upon my mind, and which I should long ago have inserted in the public papers had I not been unwilling to stir up a nest of hornets." He said, "Many gentlemen have done my brother and me, though without naming us, the honor to reprint many of our hymns. Now they are perfectly welcome to do so, provided they print them just as they are. But I desire that they would not attempt to mend them, for they are really not able. None of them is able to mend either the sense or the verse. Therefore, I must beg of them these two favors, either to let them stand just as they are, to take things for better or worse, or to add the true reading in the margin or at the bottom of the page, that we may no longer be accountable either for the nonsense or the doggerel of other men." Well, he said that, but one man did the church a great favor by polishing up one of Charles's best-loved hymns. When Charles was 32, he wrote a Christmas hymn that began, "Hark, how all the welkin rings, glory to the King of Kings, peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled, joyfully all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies, universal nature say, Christ the Lord is born today. The word welkin was an old English term.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.